Our top story tonight. As Yom Ha'Shoah comes to a close this evening, we speak to Holocaust survivor Eva Schloss MBE about her remarkable human rights work and what made her speak out about her experiences, which are the subject of a powerful play, And Then They Came For Me.
They are beating me and threatening me. Eventually they will realize I know nothing. If I did know anything, I would probably tell them. There's nothing to tell. My name is Eva Geringer. Today is my birthday. I am 15 years old. This morning, I woke up. I went down to breakfast to open my presents. And then they came for me.
And Then They Came For Me is a multimedia play about the Holocaust survivors, Eva Schloss and Ed Silverberg. And it's their trials and journey through all of the problems that arose with their families. Deborah Goodman, who is in charge of the Sussex Jewish Community Group, had contacted me immediately, and I didn't even have a cast yet, and said, would you perform this play for this Remembrance Day? And I said yes immediately, because it just seemed like someone was putting things out there to happen. To get this moving and having more people see it.
When we moved to Amsterdam in 1940, quite late already, the war was already started, but not in, that was in Poland. And we moved to the Merwede Plein, which was a big open square. And I was 11, Anne Frank was 11. And after school, all the children came out to play. And so, you know, she introduced herself. She was very polite, well brought up. And so, you know, we played together, we're friends. And as I had come from Austria and Belgium, I didn't speak Dutch. So she took me to meet her family. And this is how I got to know Otto Frank, who later, of course, became my stepfather. Coming back, I just turned 16. And I was really wanting the world to know what has happened. It was really in my head, and I really wanted to talk about it. But at that time, after the war, especially in Holland and certainly in Germany, and as well actually in England or America, partly it was guilt feeling of the people when they've seen the movies. You know, at that time, when you went to the cinema, you got the newsreel, and the liberation of the camps was shown. And I think people were in shock. And they realized perhaps they should have done something. So all people were guilty and didn't want to talk about it. Or they just thought, well, we all have suffered. We don't want to hear anymore. So that's why survivors were sort of, people didn't want to hear our stories. And then you suppress it. And then after 10, 20, 30 years, when people start to ask you, you're not ready anymore. So I got married. I didn't tell my husband what has happened, nor to my children. It was too painful to burden them with what I had suffered. But that made, of course, problems. Second generation, they say, just because the parents didn't talk about it, there was this silence about the secret. There was, in 1986, you know, in Amsterdam, that was the Anne Frank House, which was a museum where the family were hiding. And they decided they would create an exhibition, because not everybody can go to Amsterdam and go around the world to tell the story about it. And the first one was in England in 1986, and it was Ken Livingston who organized it. Ken Livingston said to me, come and sit with us, which I did. And there were questions, and then he said, and now Eva, we want to say something to you. Well, I tell you, I wanted to hide under the table. I was really still quite shy, and I'd never spoken about this, so what can I say, you know? I was in shock. But I got up, and I saw all those 200 pair of ears looking at me expectantly, and then suddenly the floodgate opened, and I just started to talk. And that was for me really a burden dropping. And then people said, well, you have such an interesting story, why don't you write a book? So this is where in 1988 I started to write my first book, Eva's Story. He had the exhibition in the town Hall when he was mayor of London. He had a play in the town hall. He was always very, very helpful with anything to do with Jewish things and with Anne Frank. So I don't think he's anti-Semitic. And this I would like to explain about what he's accused of again, because he said Hitler was a Zionist. And it's of course a bit silly, but on the other hand it's not that far-fetched, because Eichmann, who started the destruction of the Jews with the gassing of them, he was in 1935, 1936, very often in Jerusalem. So there was a relationship with Hitler and Israel. If the Mufti would have said yes, the Jews would have gone to Palestine and all this Holocaust wouldn't have happened. So you wouldn't say he was a Zionist, but he was thinking that the Jews came from Palestine and they should go back there. And that is really what Zionism is about. The world is, it's really a shame that they act the same as they did then, that they just close their doors for people who have to flee their country. Nobody leaves their own country from free will unless, you know, they go because they have a job and so on. But to go because they have nowhere to live and it's danger of being killed, I mean, those people have to be helped.